So we were talking about the dihybrid cross, which is shown here. And we ended with Mendel's curious question. Mendel's curious question was, do alleles always go together? Do alleles always go together in a plant? That's supposed to be a question mark. So in other words, do we always have yellow peas that are smooth? And do we always have green peas that are wrinkled, or can green peas also be smooth? So if you can only have yellow smooth and green wrinkled, then those alleles probably go together. If the answer to the question here is that green peas can also be smooth, then yes, those two particular traits for the pea shape, smooth versus wrinkled, and the pea color, yellow versus green, they're not inherited together all the time. In other words, they become inherited independently. So we can make some cross predictions here based off the answer to this question, yes and no. Yes, that it's independent inheritance. No, that it's dependent inheritance. So cross prediction for that first option of dependent inheritance or dependent assortment. Cross prediction or dependent assortment. If I have a parent generation that is yellow and smooth cross to a pea that is green and wrinkled, which is what we see here, yellow, smooth, green, and wrinkled. In the F1, what we should expect to see is all yellow and smooth. Now, the F1, we would see the exact same thing if this was independent assortment. So we can't stop at the F1. We actually have to go to the F2. In the F2, if we were to breed out our yellow smooth peas and its dependent assortment, what we should expect in the F2 is to find 3 out of 4 plants with a yellow smooth phenotype, and 1 out of 4 with a green wrinkled phenotype. In other words, if both seed color and seed morphology assort dependent of each other, we should expect to see a ratio equivalent to 3 to 1, just like we saw in the hybrid cross.
Why did I just
write the yellow? Yellow smooth, that's a good question. Let's go ahead and draw it out. So these are my two parents. Pea number one is my yellow, my wrinkled, or smooth rather. And then over here I have my green and wrinkled. So if they assort dependent, that means that another way that I could draw this would look like this. And then you see where this is going. Those are the chromosomes. And if they're dependent, it means they're probably on the same chromosome. So when they split, you always get the gamete that can be produced. The only gamete that can be produced is going to be big Y, big R. Over here, the only type of gamete that you would be able to get would be little y, little r. Now, in all reality, even if it's independent assortment, you would see the exact same thing. Because this only can give the gene for yellow and the gene for smooth. It can't give the gene for green or wrinkled because it doesn't, the alleles don't exist.
Pause for a second. So you're saying in the independent one, if you cross the yellows,
I haven't gotten anything. I'm just showing you the dependent assortment. If it's dependent assortment, so dependent assortment, this is a P. And in that P, it has this chromosomal composition. So on one chromosome, I have an allele for yellow and the allele for smooth. On the other chromosome, I have the allele for yellow and the allele for smooth. Independent, so that's going to be dependent assortment. If it's independent assortment, I'm going to have four different chromosomes. One that contains the yellow and one that contains both of the smooth. Now, when they line up on the metaphase plate, I have a variety of different options. Let me put some colors in here. So let's say that's mom and that's dad in the red and the yellow. So my chromosomes, when they line up on the metaphase plate, so you can make this one yellow and this one red, they could look like that. Or I could have the red, the yellow, and yellow. And now when these split, I'm going to get a gamete that contains those two and a gamete that contains those two. This is the parent generation. When I get down to the F1, I'm going to redraw it so you can see what the consequences would be for independent and dependent. This is making some sense. So my F2, let's go back to the F2 here. F2 is showing an expected ratio of 3:1. So for dependent, let me just take you through, and we'll start out with two different, these are parents. These are the parents. So here, this is the parent generation. I'm going to have to add some colors. There's my two parents. They each have their own set of chromosomes, one from mom and one from dad, and from their parents. So the gametes that can be produced here are either going to be yellow containing or red containing. Over here, it's going to be the same. Yellow containing and red containing. Okay? Now if I add in some numbers or some letters, big R, big Y, big R, and big Y, because the alleles are the same. Over here it's little r, little y, because the alleles are the same. So when I So when I distribute this chromosome, this gamete here, little r, little y, big R, big Y, big R, they like. Okay, so those are the gametes. So I put them into a cross. I can pick either of these two and either of these two to put into the cross. Right? I'll draw my planet square. Choose this one, big R, big Y. Choose that one, big R, big Y. You do the exact same. Choose these two here, same thing, big R, little Y. Now go through and distribute them. Ah, I keep choosing myself. R, Y, little R, Y. So the big R comes in, the little R comes in. Oh, Y, I'm over. Oh, gosh. Let's just start over. I can choose this one that has an R and a Y on it, and then I'm only going to write R's. Well, hopefully.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, but my problem is I'm just writing down the wrong letters. R and Y. R and Y. Little R, little Y, little R, little Y. It's going to be that for all of them, right? Big R, little R, little Y, big Y, which is equivalent. Big R, big Y, little Y, big R, little R, big Y, little Y from here, big Y from here. All of them are equivalent. R, R, Y, Y. So they are all one. The other one is. Now, this is the F1. What about the F2? This is the only type of genome I can select, or genotype I can select. So someone tell me, from this particular genotype, what is the independent assortment going to look like? The independent assortment, I'm sorry, dependent assortment. The big R and the big Y have to go together, following the convention here. I can only get the big R and the big Y on the chromosome, and I can only get the little R and the little Y on the chromosome. Because they're together, spatially together, and I'm giving you kind of the look ahead because we didn't know about chromosomes at the time. But we know that it would be dependent if they were on the same chromosome. So what are the gametes that can be produced here? Those are the only two types of gametes. Yes. I could do a 16 here, and I'm going to get the exact same results. So basically, the gametes that you can produce in an individual is going to be big R, big Y, or a gamete of little R, little Y. And the other individual who has that genotype, a dependent assortment, can produce a big R, big Y gamete or a little R, little Y gamete. Those are the only two options that that individual can produce. Is everybody with me? I can distribute this into a gamete, or I can distribute that into a gamete. I can't do anything else. Is everybody good? There's my four different genotypes. All of these, what do they look like? Yellow smooth. That one, what does it look like? Green and rainbow. Dependent assortment says it has to be a 3-to-1 ratio. That's dependent assortment. Now let's talk about independent assortment. So for my cross prediction, for my independent assortment, my parent generation, taking yellow smooth, true breeding plant, crossing it to a green wrinkled true breeding plant. So that's what we see here. They cross together. The only types of, in that parent generation, the only type of gamete my R only type of gamete that can be produced is going to be an R wide containing gamete. Now look at this. Now they can be on separate chromosomes. So in reality, what we could do here, it's all going to be equivalent, but I could line them up on the metaphase plate so I get a yellow or a red and a red. Let me draw it out. Let me show you the different metaphase plates. They're all going to be equivalent. Remember that. It's all going to be big R, little r. So the possible metaphase plates that I could produce, need to go yellow and yellow, R and Y, R and Y, which when they split would give me the yellow, yellow in one of my gametes, R and Y, and then R and Y from the other parent's chromosome. So these are totally equivalent. The other metaphase plate that could develop, would be to have the yellow show up and then the yellow clear up. Still, it's going to be big R, little r. I mean, big R, little y. And big Y, big Y. Now, these two new gametes that can be produced would be yellow, yellow, R, Y, Y, and R, and then the red and the red. All four of these equivalent to that. Everybody see that? So then, no matter which one of these I choose, no matter which gametes that I choose, when I draw up the Punnett square, one parent would be RY, RY, the other parent, little r, little y, and Olivia, if I wanted to expand this and do a 16, I'm just writing down all four of those possibilities in both directions. Does everybody follow me? Does that make sense? So I know that I don't need to do that just because I already know what the answer is. So all of my individuals across the whole thing are big R, little r, big Y, little r. Now, that individual, let's take that individual, here's that cell, and again, we have our four different chromosomes, and it's going to be big R, little r, big Y, little y. Now, if they independently assort in mitosis, that would be one of my metaphase plates. The other metaphase plate looks like that, r, little y, and then big Y. So here are my gametes, r, y, little r, little y, big R, little y, little r, big Y. There's my four possible gametes from every parent. So now I have to put them all on my Punnett square. So now I'm using the 16. And that's what's drawn up here. I'm not going to draw. I'm going to use this as my figure. So what have I written down so far? P1 is going to be the smooth wrinkle. Before we get down to the F2, what would the F1 look like?
Yellow smooth.
And then here's our F2 generation. So here are all of our possible gametes that can be lined up. And you go through and you just distribute. And then you count up. And what you can see is I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 that are smooth and yellow. 1, 2, 3 that are smooth and green. 1, 2, 3 that are smooth and wrinkled. And 1 that's smooth or that's green and wrinkled. So 9 out of the 16 are yellow and smooth. 3 out of the 16 are green and smooth. Three are yellow and smooth. And 4 would be 1 out of 16 are green and wrinkled.
Should
the 3 out of 16 be yellow and green? Yes. Okay. Yellow smooth, green smooth, yellow wrinkle, green wrinkle. Does that help? So as you're going through these problems, think about, in terms of chromosomes, which gives you a huge advantage that we know chromosomes is where the DNA holds the genes, because Mendel didn't know that. Mendel didn't know that it was chromosomes. But he basically was saying, if they're dependent assorting, then they have to go together always. And if they are, so you have those two gametes only. If they are not dependent assorted, then you can have a big R and a little Y, a little R and a big Y, or you could have the big R, the big Y, or the little R and the little Y. So it increases the number of gametes that you can possibly produce. So this expected ratio down here can be represented as a 9 to 3 to 3 to 1. So if you get a data set, you can go through and you can check the ratio. And I'm going to show you Mendel's data that he got for this particular cross in just a second. So does everybody know? I'm going to show you the data that Mendel actually got for this particular cross once you have everything you need here. Okay, so the results of that particular experiment, and he said, okay, if I see a 3-to-1 ratio, I know that it's going to be what kind of assortment? 3-to-1 ratio would give me dependent, 9-to-3-to-3-to-1. 9-to-3-to-3-to-1, independent. So he found 315 yellow and smooth, 108 that were green and smooth, 101 that were yellow and wrinkled, and 32 that were green and wrinkled. You don't even have to do the math, but you can see that this is quite a bit higher than this by almost a factor of 10, let's call it 9, and then these two are basically the same, and they're about 3 times less, 9-to-3-to-3-to-1. So Mendel said it's independent assortment. And Mendel was actually correct, but incorrect at the same time. In fact, the whole area of classical genetics or Mendelian genetics is correct, but incorrect all at the same time. And the reason that is because there are Mendelian traits, or traits that are defined by one gene and one gene alone. And those individual genes, we've actually now recognized that they assort independently, and some of them can assort dependently. So both options are a possibility. Most of the genes that we have in the human body are called complex traits. But that means that they're defined by more than one gene. Right now, we believe that body size in humans is genetically defined by over 100 individual genes. That would be a very complex trait. So you can only use Mendelian genetics. It has limited but useful utility for a variety of different traits. But most of the traits you look at, you have to use more complex techniques. Okay. So let's talk a little bit more about the Punnett square that we've already been using and we can use to predict the results. This is just a method to keep us organized. So we can use this to predict results and then to go on to test hypotheses. So here's an example of a Punnett square. I've already seen a lot of these. In this particular Punnett square, we're taking two different flowers, purple, or two different plants with purple flowers, and you can see that we get this distribution of a 3-to-1 ratio. We are going to take a look at the yellow pea and the green pea. Now, when using the Punnett square, the first thing to do is to set your allele designators. And you remember that there's a convention for setting your allele designators. And that convention is to determine or to use your recessive allele as your designator, the name of your recessive allele as your designator. So what letter am I going to use to represent a yellow pea? Green is the recessive. So big G.
Why did we just lock?
because I started out with a picture. It does not follow that convention, but it was a good picture. In reality, it doesn't technically matter, but it's good convention to keep. Because they do convey meaning. Alright, so we set our allele designators, G for yellow pea, big G for capital G for yellow pea, lowercase g for the green pea. So if we do a true breeding cross here in our parent generation, my yellow is going to have two alleles, both coding for the yellow phenotype. Big G, times little g. The next step is to determine your gametes. What are the gametes that can be produced? In a monohybrid cross, it's really, really simple. You just simply split your genotype for both parents. So the results of the F1 is going to equal big G and little g. And that's because the two types of gametes that I can get here, so these are my gametes, are big G, little g. So I can put them on my Punnett square, take my big G's and my little G's, and then just distribute through. And normally when you distribute through, you bring down first, and then you bring over. Okay? And so there's how I get that 100% are going to be big G and little G. Now, if I take the results of my cross, my F1 generation, and I self-fertilize. Self-fertilize the F1 generation. What are the parent, what is going to be the parent genotype? Big G, little g for both of my parents. So what are the possible gametes that can be produced? So big G here, little g here, big G here, little g here. So I throw those into a cross. So really the cross that I'm going to be doing here, it's going to be a big G, little g by big G, little g cross. Define my gametes, big G, little g, and then a big G over here, and a little g over here. Distribute down first, and then across. There are four different genotypes. These two are equivalent. And normally convention is to write these two as that. But in reality, showing this, you can see that there are one quarter of my population has a genotype of big G, big G. One quarter has genotype of little g, big G. One quarter has big G, little g, and the last quarter has g, g. Okay? I just quantify the Punnett square. And we're going to see where that utility comes in here in just a second. We're running out of time. So results of the F2, all of these are going to be yellow. So I have three that are yellow because they're all have a dominant that's present. So there's the three genotypes for the yellow. And then one is green, because there is no dominant present. The last thing that I'm going to do today is I'm going to give you a little primer for after the break. Mendelian inheritance, and now adding in the idea of probability. So just to give you a little primer on probability, real quick, I have 52 cards, all of them are different deck of cards. What's the probability of pulling out the ace of hearts? 52 cards in the deck. 1 in 52. What's the probability of pulling out an ace? 4 out of 52 or 1 out of 15. Okay. We can begin to set probabilities for each of our different factors on the Punnett square. In that F2 cross that I did, or the cross I did to generate the F2, you can look at this. This is the parent. What is the probability for a G versus a little g? I have two total possibilities, one of each, 1 over 2, 1 over 2. So from this parent, each of these I can put in as 1/2 probability, getting that particular gamete from each of these parents. Then I begin to put in, and I'll just do this first one, my g and my g, what's 1/2 times 1/2? 1/2 times 1/2.
1/4.
So now I have the ability to begin to quantify these probabilities. All right, 3 o'clock today, is that what we decided on? What's that? I didn't like it. Anyway. Someplace upstairs. We'll find a place to do it upstairs. First thing I need all of you to do is get out of panic mode.
I'm in less in paper trail than I was before. I guess, I don't know. I'm so infected. Draw the skills. The hardest part for me is those long words. Like, I just stopped. And I understand that the
end of it is. Been abbreviated, PFK.
Can you do that? You understand what I'm saying?
I mean, as long as your abbreviation is is not like...
Clean up.
Phosphofructokinase, I'm abbreviating as dog.
Well, because like in... the cycle in photosynthesis, it's like...